Why that doesn't work. There, now it works. All right. So we're talking about footprinting and social engineering. Footprinting is learning about a company by examining them from the outside. It is generally legal. It's also called competitive intelligence, where you hire one company to spy upon your competitors and see what they're doing. I know I used to work at an escrow agency under contract to the Federal Trade Commission, and one of the things we did was handle lawsuits, and people who were part of the lawsuits would call in for information, and a large percentage of the calls we got were from lawyers on our own cases making sure that what we were saying was correct, or spies from other companies in the same business calling to see what we were doing. And that's just a thing, you know. Anyway, so that's one thing, finding out what people are doing from the outside. Then there's DNS. DNS has zone transfers, which turn out to be extremely useful, primarily because of one of the many mistakes Microsoft made in designing their DNS system. And then social engineering, which is similar activity. So you look over a company to find their weaknesses. I mean, this has become a habit with me. I remember I think they threw me out of a restaurant one time, a Subway. I walked in, and the first thing I did was ask them why they placed their security camera where they did, and they said, "You're a suspicious guy, you have to get out of here." But I tried to, they didn't care about my excuse. But anyway, so you look at things, you find the weaknesses in the alarms and such. That's what people did to case banks before breaking in, or homes before breaking in, and you can do the same thing to websites and companies. You look at the resumes there of the jobs, the people that work there, you look at their description of what skills are needed for a job there, and you can determine what kind of firewall they're using, what kind of languages and servers they use, and so on. There are many tools out there to do it. Google Groups is extremely useful. It used to be called Usenet, and Google bought the Usenet archives years ago and indexed it so you can see the emails asking for help before there was Stack Exchange and modern forums to get technical help. People did it on Usenet, and that stuff is all archived forever. And in fact, people are amazingly sloppy about this because they're, like I was mentioning about the Christian Science Monitor, there was a time when only highly technical people read this stuff. And then slowly, thanks to Google and other companies, more less technical and people started reading it. But the technical folks, see, technical people have this illusion that nobody's watching them. And a lot of people are watching them. So they often have real details, source code, going to these websites. I found a website a few years ago before DEF CON that was printing checks in Texas for a Canadian bank. And their server was just wide open with no password. You could see the check data going by, and you could modify the check data going by with no password. And I contacted them and said, "Hey guys, this is not right." And they didn't answer me for a few days, so I did some more research, and I found the blog posts from the administrator that built the system 3 years earlier, going to these news groups saying, "I can't figure out how to put a password on this site. Can anybody help me?" And they struggled and just gave up and couldn't figure out how to put a password on it. So you'll often find that. People are just posting in online forums the code, exactly what the problem is. And even though that stuff really shouldn't be completely public, but a lot of technical people, they say, "If I can't figure it out, nobody can figure it out. Nobody's looking at this except the experts." This illusion of how important and powerful and special you are is the bane of this field. Anyway, Sam Spade is one of the tools that will help you look for information about people online. It was originally designed to help people find the source of spam email messages. I don't know if you got them here. There's some people that are very, very, very angry about spam, and they are on the warpath. It's their big cause. Anyway, there's other tools out there that will help scrape websites to find all the data on a website. You can pretty easily run a spider and copy every page of a website and then search through it for keywords, but there are other tools that try to help you extract data from pages. There's a large commercial reason to perfect these tools, which is to send spam. There is a process called data mining, which, like search engine optimization, has a legal and an illegal side. Data mining is going into a large pile of data and somehow extracting useful data from it. And that could be legal, but it's generally done in order to send spam. So if you search many websites on the internet, you can find email addresses, and then you can send those people emails about whatever your product is and market them. And so there's a large commercial business with both good and bad sides driving the development of these tools. All right, then there's a lot of other tools out there, white pages. I just used Dig, we'll be back to that. And wget is another way to download pages from the command line. There's a lot of tools you can use, up to Maltego. Maltego, yeah, will come up in a couple of these. I'll mention it when we get there. All right, so there's lots of ways to find information. Typically, the most informative thing you can find is the target company's website themselves. They usually post a lot of information. But if they don't, other people will post information about them. And so if you don't want people finding this out, you have to have a closed shop that is sort of paranoid, where all your employees are afraid to speak out. That Apple is the king of this. Apple is like a walled fortress. Nobody at Apple can tell you anything about the new iPhone, the new version of anything, when anything is coming out, what it will look like. When some guy left a model of the new iPhone in a bar, this turned into a giant scandal as people had the stolen phone and were going to leak it, and they were going to pay thousands of dollars to get it back. They're like a embattled government. And that was a tradition of Steve Jobs, that he would control all the announcements to make it just the right way. And Microsoft is switching to more and more like that. But that's what you have to do. You have to. Everyone has to be afraid to talk to the press, or everything will leak out of your company, of course. So you can analyze websites a lot of ways. Burp Suite is the main tool that hackers use. So let me just show you Burp in all its glory. Burp has a commercial version, which I've never used, but it has a free version, which is quite nice. So it's a Java tool, so it runs on Linux, Windows, and the Mac. There we are. They have recently upgraded it to have something called Sessions, which I don't know or care about, but it just adds a few more clicks to starting it. Okay, this is Burp. Like any other professional tool, at first it is daunting with many, many tabs full of complicated options, but you really don't need most of those to do simple things. Here's the main place you start on proxy options. This thing is a web proxy, so it will intercept traffic on the way to the internet and let you examine and alter it. By default, it's listening only on the interface 127.0.0.1.8080, and that's good enough to intercept web traffic. So let me put this on the history tab and let's bring up a browser. You have to have a browser for this kind of work. I choose a browser I don't like much, which is Firefox in my case, because the browser you use for this is frequently set up so it's hard to use for other purposes. So you go to here, and I think it's Advanced Network Settings. Okay, because I'm going to set the proxy server is what some companies use for security. So you cannot directly connect to the internet. Instead, you connect to the proxy, which serves up pages on your behalf. And I'm going to do that on my own machine. So if you do that, you have to set the proxy here, and it's 127.0.0.1 on port 8080, which is what I want. So if I do that now, and now I go to a website like ccsf.edu, a whole bunch of stuff appears here. What's going on is my browser, instead of going directly to City College, is going first to Burp, and then Burp is fetching all the pages and passing them over. And so you can see what happens when you load a page. It does a GET for the main page. This sends an HTTP request down here, which is a GET. You get a response, which is 302 found. A 302 is a redirect. The document has moved to www.ccsf.edu. I might mention, by the way, that this is the same mistake a bank made that was talking to me last week. This is an insecure practice. Now, you might notice, ultimately, the City College page, oh, this one is not secure. Okay, for a while this one was secure, but anyway. So it first finds a redirect, then it finds a 200 okay. The 200 means I've actually found the page. And so the response actually contains the page now, which is down here is all the HTML page code that makes the page. And the HTML code will then refer to things like images and style sheets and JavaScript, and so there will now be a whole bunch more requests grabbing every little piece of the page one by one. This is going to come back to be very important to us as we get into web bugs and cookies. If you can add anything to a page which is then fetched later, it can come from a different server. Like notice, we're loading City College, now we're suddenly loading something from Google. Not that we wanted to go to Google. Suppose we hated Google. We were afraid Google spies on you and they're a rotten company. I don't want to have anything to do with them. Tough. When you go to some page that has nothing to do with Google, they're likely to load something from Google. That's, of course, an issue. You don't really know who you're talking to. You don't really know who's putting stuff on your machine. Not if you just run a browser. Anyway, so that's how you can view normal web traffic in a proxy. And you can do more with a lot more with proxies. They add a lot more features to them. Here's the Burp proxy running and how to set it up. So if you surf a normal site, you'll just see all the requests. And if you go to a secure site, you'll get an interesting error message. And let me bring that up. So if I go to samsclass.info, okay, your connection is not secure. Now, this is interesting, and this is the point of HTTPS. If you don't use HTTPS, you do not know who you're talking to. You don't know who the server is because you can just lie about the DNS response. I could send you to a fake page that looks good and you'd have no way to tell at all that it's not the right page. But the whole point of secure pages is that you can't fake them easily. So this request, you notice there is no HTTPS request in my list here. It's been blocked. My browser, because the browser tried to make the HTTPS handshake and it blocked it here, the owner of samsclass.info has not configured their website properly. So you can learn more here. Your connection is not secure. Let's see if there should be a way. Here we are. Here's the exact error, unknown issuer. And I should be able to view the certificate, here we go. Get certificate. And here's the certificate that that web page handed out. And I can view it here. That's what I wanted to show you. So the certificate is from PortSwigger. PortSwigger is the company that writes Burp. So what happens is, if you try to make a secure connection through Burp, if you actually made an HTTPS connection directly to the server would hand you a public key, and no one on earth would be able to read that traffic except the server. Now that would defeat the whole point of Burp. The point of Burp is so you can examine the requests going through. So Burp performs a man-in-the-middle attack. It makes a fake certificate to hand out a fake public key, so your browser will encrypt with a public key where Burp has the private key. Then it can open the traffic, examine it, re-encrypt it, and pass it on. This is what proxy servers have to do if they want to examine encrypted traffic. And the browser will detect this because that's the whole point of HTTPS. Burp doesn't have a real certificate for my page, so it puts up a fake one, and the browser warns me it's fake. If you choose to trust this thing, it is an option to trust it. If I just say, get certificate, confirm security exception. Now I've told it to accept this. And now it's going to send me to pages here. If I go to samsclass.info, I have to do the same process, advanced, add exception, and confirm security exception. Now I can surf this supposedly secure page. And even though it is supposedly secure, it's not. You can see I'm now seeing requests and responses happening here, which I shouldn't be able to see. I should only be able to see encrypted garbage there. So this is what you have to do if you want to intercept responses. So as you can see, if you use a ordinary product like Burp to try to do a man-in-the-middle attack, HTTPS will warn your users, and most of them will never see the page because you see the browsers make it very difficult to overcome this warning intentionally. So companies are not happy with that. Suppose you're a large company and you want to filter email for viruses. It's not acceptable to let people make encrypted connections that you can't see going through your firewall, moving God knows what through them. You have to open them. So you need to either put up fake certificates from your own certificate authority and then install it as a trusted authority in all the browsers, in all the computers that use it, which might work if people are using their company laptop. But if you want people's ordinary devices that they brought from home to work without a warning, you have to become a certificate authority. And you have to become a trusted certificate authority, which is very difficult because there's only about 100 of them. And so what you really do, and what has been happening for 10 years secretly and only gradually emerging into the light, is you bribe a real certificate authority into selling you a valid root certificate. And they have been doing this for police agencies, national governments, and any rich company with enough money for years. And only about 4 years ago did people start admitting this practice. So it is this is the fundamental weakness of HTTPS. HTTPS means you know who you're talking to, but the only reason you know is because you trust these third parties. And if the third parties can be convinced to lie to you, you don't know who you're talking to anymore. And that's kind of the current situation. But it does fit, I think, basic American values. The only people that can spy on you are the government or rich people. And really, that's the way it's always been. It's just people have an illusion that it's been different. Anyway, so that's Burp intercepting encrypted traffic. And you'll see a warning in that case, unless you can actually get a genuine root certificate, and those are not available for most of us. All right, so you can now modify requests. There are some websites where you buy a product and the price is just in your request. So if I send a different price, I'll actually get it at a different price. This is a very common mistake. When you use the web, many computers are involved, the web server, the routers and proxies on the way, and then your laptop, and the developer often doesn't really remember or understand which computer is being used to do different parts of the calculation. So they put essential parts in something like client-side JavaScript that can be modified and don't realize this is unsafe. So you can often get away with murder by modifying requests passing through a proxy. You know, we've got a web security class here, or 129S, where we do a lot of that. You can also spider the site, where you just click every link and save every page. That's an automatic process. And you can scan for vulnerabilities to some extent with a proxy. They're not particularly designed for this as well as professional vulnerability scanners, but they have some ability to do it, like Zed. The Zed Attack proxy from OWASP has a simple vulnerability scanner, which is okay. It is illegal to scan for vulnerabilities without the permission of the owner of the website. It is, in fact, illegal to detect vulnerabilities by any means, even if you can spot them by just seeing them. It is illegal to be intelligent and see them. This is rather quite, the law says if you send a signal of any kind to a protected server, and the result is you gain information you are not authorized to have, you have now broken the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. Tampered data is a very simple proxy-like thing that lets you intercept responses inside Firefox. And the Chrome developer tools will let you examine what the browser sent and received, even without a proxy. And that's worth mentioning. So let me bring up Chrome. If you wanted to see the request and responses here, it's just View Developer Tools. And now you have a lot of things here. And the Network tab, for example, if you go to the Network tab and refresh this page, it will show you the requests. Here's a request and response, request and response, request and response. And it also shows you stuff like how long it took for each request and response to happen. If I go to a more complicated page, that'll be more interesting. Let's go to like abc.tv. All right, that's a complicated page. That was a lot of pieces to that page. And you see this piece took that long, and then it requested this one, which took a little longer, and that one. And so if your page is loading slowly, you can use this to decide which component is taking too long and troubleshoot it. And you can see the exact request and response for every part of this page. Here's the headers and the response headers. Here's the response, the request and response coming here and all the timing. So it's really quite useful. And by the way, it can be a secure page and it doesn't matter. Because this is not a proxy, it is the browser itself showing you the signals before they were encrypted. So this is a secure website, and this is an HTTPS request, and yet I can see the exact request and I can see the response here because I'm not intercepting the network traffic on the wire. The browser is showing me the traffic before it encrypted it and the response after it decrypted it. So there's no security problem here, and it's not a proxy, but it does let you do a lot of things a proxy would do to test your website. All right, and let's get this thing back up here. All right, so that's developer tools and the timeline and such. Whois is another useful tool. Every domain name has to be owned by somebody. You have to pay to have one. You go to a domain name registrar, occasionally you can get them for free, but you own it only for a certain amount of time. If you quit paying the bill for your domain name, it will become available and somebody else could buy it. This actually is a kind of powerful attack. It is quite common that major companies will forget to renew their domain, and you can run in and buy it, and if you do, then you get all their email because it goes to your server now until they catch on. There's another very powerful technique called typo squatting. If you want to get some money, you can have some company, like suppose you hate Donald Trump. You're probably Trump.com, I imagine there is, and it may or may not be him, but it's somebody like him. But suppose there's somebody you know that you want to mess with. You take their domain name, and if they haven't bought their domain name, you buy it first. Then you say, I'm not giving it to you unless you give me $1 million. This is domain name squatting. But there's also triber squatting. You can put in misspelled versions of the name, like this, or maybe two R's, or something like that. And the point is, when people type in email addresses, they make mistakes. So some portion of email addresses are actually going to that domain. And there was a conference I went to a couple years ago where they set up about a dozen of these typo squatting domains, and they got terabytes of proprietary company email coming to them because it just goes in somebody's email list, and they might not notice for years that one of the contacts is actually going to the wrong domain. Yeah?
Do you remember the Goggle scandal?
I know that Goggle.com is something, yeah.
Yeah, it's good now.
Yeah, there's a bunch of them, sure. There's a whole bunch of these. In fact, what a lot of people do is buy them and then put up malware pages and pages that put up ads and stuff. So, I mean, misspelled domain names are quite a trick on the web. Anyway, so it's that's another fun one. So you can use Whois to find out who the official owner of a domain is. So let me do a couple of them in case I haven't. You can just do it from the command line. It's a service your ISP provides. So let me make that bigger. Okay, if I do Whois, ccsf.edu, it will tell me exactly who it is. And this should give you a real human, and it does. That's our network operation manager, Tim Ryan. It gives you his phone number, his mailbox, his email address, because we're a legitimate company, and you should have a real person. If you have anything you want to say about the CCS.edu domain, you should be able to reach a real person if we're a legitimate company. If you want to say, I hate your website, or you stole my material, that's copyrighted stuff, or anything you want to say, there should be somebody that will talk to you if you're a legitimate company. So we've got a real guy there. I've got one too, I hope. Who is? Who is samsclass.info? Yeah, there you go. This one and one. That's strange. I didn't. One and one. Oh, yeah, it is one and one. That's right. But they should have. I did not hide my name. There we are. You have my real address and real name, right? So if you want to know who owns this rotten website, why don't you take it down, which I get a lot of actually, then you can reach me. Most domain registrars, however, do not verify this information. So you can put up Mickey Mouse, Donald Duck, anything you want, and they'll just fill it in. There have been attempts frequently to pass laws requiring domain registrars to actually get a photo ID and verify that these things are real, but those laws have never passed, so there's no enforcement. So it is voluntary to put that information there, but almost any legitimate company does put real information there, because if somebody calls your domain name registrar and says, I'm sorry, I had to move to another server, change the address, the only way they can tell if it's legitimate or not is from that information. So if that's Donald Duck, they can't tell if you're the real guy or a fake administrator tricking them. And this is why you can put on domain name locks to prevent your domain name from moving, and that is a very good idea. I just got paid $250 a week ago from a company that I warned 3 years ago about this, because the New York Times got hacked this way by the Syrian Electronic Army. The Syrian Electronic Army at that time was one 17-year-old loyal to Assad, and he was hacking everybody to put up pro-Syrian messages, and he hacked the New York Times by calling their domain registrar and convincing them on the phone that he was the official New York Times administrator, and they had to move it to a different server. And the whole New York Times website went to another server for about a day. It is a weak spot in many companies that they don't know about. You got firewalls and passwords and everything, and what good is that? I can just call your domain name registrar and lie to them, and suddenly your website is gone. Or your website has been replaced by political propaganda or something offensive, you know. Anyway, so that's the game there. You can see who owns things. Then Sam Spade will do this in a graphical environment, and he'll do a lot of other things too. And I mentioned before Multigo. A lot of people sing the praises of Multigo. I've never gotten any use out of it. But if you've seen like these conspiracy theory movies where there's a guy and his wall is just covered with pictures and lines and arrows, and this guy went here and dates, and they come up with this plan about how the U.S. government did 9/11 because George Bush's second cousin once removed was in the building and left 5 minutes before the plane crashed, and all these complicated things. That's what Multigo is. It takes websites and people and companies and automatically looks up all this information about them, and then it shows they're connected. This guy is connected to that company and married to the person on this board and has a cousin that's on that board. And all this stuff does is make me crazy. But experts claim you can actually prove meaningful things here. The main problem with it, of course, is the famous statement that everybody is only seven steps removed from everybody else. So if you look too deeply, everything is tied to everything. So. But apparently, there are some people that like it, and we'll do this all automatically. I know if you put me in any of these maps, it's completely useless, because I post like 20 or 30 news links a day, so it shows 10,000 arrows connecting me to everything in the planet. So what exactly does that tell you? Anyway, then there's another thing called domain dossier. This is actually a very powerful investigative technique. If you own a domain, like I just showed you, you have to pay money to get a domain. So often you use a credit card, and you outperform, they fill out with your real name. So it turns out that anybody that's been on the internet for a while has probably owned several domains, and there are records of their real name and real address at some point. This is how they caught the people in MulSec that hacked everybody in 2011 and 2012, because first they were little kids, and they played games, and they bought domains and put in their real name. Then a few years later, they decided to start doing crimes. Then they did worse and worse crimes until they were really being hunted by government agencies everywhere, and yet there was a path leading back. This blog would mention that domain. This username would be similar to that domain. And you could just track it back to their earlier time when they were not criminals yet, and they put their real name in the information. So it's actually quite powerful. Just look at old Whois records and old domain DNS records, and you can find out who people are. This is true of a lot of criminal businesses, like scammers. You can trace them back to the previous company, back to before they were criminals when they weren't hiding, and find out who they are. If you actually want to hide on the internet, it takes an enormous amount of discipline. And like, the only person I know that has effectively done it is the Jester, who is not very important anymore, but he does serve as an example that you can be a criminal on the internet, seriously piss off the most dangerous people on earth for years, and get away with it if you are really, really careful. But it requires a military level of discipline. You have to never mess up, never connect without your VPN, never accidentally type in the wrong name anywhere. And he apparently has done that because he's been hunted by intelligence agencies all over the world for years and they can't find him. The thing he did to annoy them was he took down Islamic terrorist websites with denial of service attacks, and also American government websites he didn't agree with, and pretty much anybody that irritated him. But he did it all under a fake identity called the Jester, and nobody has ever found out who he is. 14 people have been accused of being the Jester, including me. For a while, people thought I was the Jester. I'm not. Anyway, so, but nobody knows who he is, and he's still more or less at it, and nobody can find it. So it can be done, but it's a whole lot harder than people think it is. And 99% of all ordinary criminals that try to hide on the internet are very easily caught by just Google searching through their previous names. They think they're hiding, but they're not really hiding in a way that will stop anybody that wants to find them. So anyway, email addresses are quite useful to track down messages people have posted from the company, like the administrator asking for help. And you can usually pretty quickly determine the pattern of email addresses. It's usually something like firstname.lastname@company.com or something like that. So it's really pretty easy to get them. So you should know the basics of how HTTP works. As you can see, there's a GET going up to a server. I looked at those earlier. So it sends up to port 80, a SYN-SYNACK ACK. Then it sends an HTTP GET. Then it gets a HTTP reply. A good reply is 200, which means I found the page, here's the page. If it doesn't find the page, there are various errors. The most common is 404, not found, which means you spelled something wrong or the page has been moved and this link is out of date. There are other ones, proxy authentication required, a request timeout, and so on, various reasons why it was unable to fetch a page. And then there's server errors, where the server actually had some kind of script error. I get these all the time because I use a lot of PHP scripts, and every time you put in a missing semicolon, everybody gets 500 requests when they go to that page. This means something's wrong on the server. The code is bad on the server. This means if you have a dynamic web page where you're writing scripts, which almost everybody does, you have two choices. The professional choice is to have two versions of it, the production version and the development version, which nobody can see but your developers, and they work on it here until they get the errors out, and then they roll it out. But if you're a slob like me and most people with small websites, you just work on a real website. There is no development service. So when I get like a 500, there's an error in my script. So now you have two choices. You can either try to guess what it is, or you can turn on error reporting so errors appear right in the browser. That's what I've done on some of my servers, which is an unprofessional move because it makes it easier for people to hack into your server. But it's very common at small websites because now instead of just getting a 500 error, you get a PHP syntax error on line 12. Here's the line. But so do the hackers attacking you get that information. So it's a cheap and sleazy approach and the one I use on my deliberately vulnerable servers. Anyway, so that's the most basic method. You just send up a GET HTTP 1.1 followed by a host colon hostname because HTTP 1.1 requires that. There are methods. The most common method is GET. GET will just send a URL to the server, the address you put in the address bar, and get that page. Host will send up data, which is not in there, something like a username and password or credit card number being sent. Then head will give you just the head response, but not the entire response, which is of very little use and not used that often. And the rest of these aren't used very often at all. So let me just do a couple of them live. In Linux or the Mac, it's very easy. In Windows, it is inconvenient, but possible to do this by hand. So I can do a netcat to a server. Let's do AOL.com on port 80. And then that should connect. And because it said nothing, it connected. This is, by the way, one thing that confuses beginners a lot. In Linux, when things work, it says nothing. It only gives you an error if things didn't work. So GET slash HTTP slash 1.1 host AOL.com. There we are. So I got information, moved permanently. I got a 301 error, which means it is moved to another site. 302 is the most common redirect, but here's another. Although I'm sort of interested, I netcatted to AOL looking for www.aol, and it told me that it's at www.aol. So I guess what they want me to do is do this, www, and now HTTP GET get slash http slash 1.1 host. Apparently not. All right. Anyway, now let's play around here. Let's see what else I can do with AOL. If I can do netcat to AOL, I can now do options. HTTP, HTTP, come on, slash 1.1, host. Oh, there it is. Okay, so it sent a request that it couldn't understand, which might have just been my replacement, but that's common. So let me do head and see if it works, and then I'll get back to the slides. HTTP slash 1.1. Okay, again, I might not be doing it right. What happens if I just do head? Yeah, it doesn't like it. All right, I don't quite know how to do a head in the command line, but the point is, head will just show you the header information, just the server information without the page. It's not something you normally want. And put is used by mobile apps sometimes to send data to the server, like post, but it's not typically used by browsers. The rest of these are very rarely used, but it's mostly get and post to feed pages and send up data. Anyway, if you want to do it on Windows, you have to do a lot of nonsense to trick Windows into letting you do this. A far more simple procedure than tricking the Windows built-in tools into doing this is to just install netcat, and then you get an ncat command line tool that works like netcat on Linux. Yeah? No. Terminal does RS-232 serial connections, not this kind of thing. You can use PuTTY, though. But you pretty much have to add a third-party tool these days. Now you don't get Telnet at all by default, and even if you do get Telnet, it's very irritating to use because by default, it hides all the text from you. So Microsoft is just very hostile to letting people do this. Anyway. All right, there's an options working as it should. It's option star HTTP 1.1, that's what I did wrong. And that will show you what methods are allowed on this server. And occasionally servers let you do awful things like send files up and put them on the server without authentication, but that's very rare. There's get. All right, so I got a few iClicker questions. If you don't have one, come and get one. And my device should be running. Let's see what happens. Looks pretty good. Okay, which one of these will retrieve the entire page from website? There. Every page. All right, looks like I can quit at 30. All right, and that's a spider. Clicks on every link and then clicks on every further link, and on it goes until it's found every page that is linked. One thing people often do is they put a page on the server that is not intended to be public information, and then they don't put a link to it, and they say, nobody will find it. This is like putting a key under the mat. The problem is Google will find it. Google is very good at guessing every possible name. And this has happened many times. One of the most common things is teachers have a list of students that's confidential with something like social security numbers, and it ends up on Google. They put it on the server. It happened here, you know. It's the simple rule, which is amazing, is if you don't have something that is not public, don't put it on a web server. Don't put it on Facebook and then imagine that the whole world can't see it. But somehow, an endless number of people keep doing this. They put it on the web, and yet they don't want everybody to see it. Don't do that. Anyway. Yeah.
So if there's, even if there's no link to it anywhere on the web?
Yes. Yes. If there's no link to it, then a simple spider wouldn't find it. But there are search engines that find it, and the Google search bot is very good. They just have a list of like the 10,000 most common words, and they'll try that. And you can download tools that will try that too. So it turns out, and you can take all the names that are there and put like a one or two or old or something. It turns out, you know, if it's on the server, it's pretty likely to be found. All right. Another thing people do is make a directory which they think isn't public, but it can be reached and it often is reached. Anyway, okay, which one of these makes a fake HTTPS certificate for every page? Quit at 40. Although maybe 30 would have been enough. All right, and that is Burp. Burp performs a man-in-the-middle attack. Works pretty well. All right. All right, if you just view a web page normally, what method is being used? That's get. Good, a popular answer. All right. All right, which one will tell you the contact information for the owner of the site? All right, and that's who is. By the way, I learned the hard way, your ISP's rate limit your who is. I was trying to notify thousands of websites about something, and if you run more than like 100 an hour, they block you off. I was actually like driving. I found an online source that wasn't limited, but I was going to drive from coffee house to try to get the ones I needed. Anyway. All right. So which one will let you type in HTTP requests manually? Something you might want to do while testing things or just learning about it, but not the thing most people want to do. And that is, Telnet on that list. Okay, Telnet will let you do it. You can do it with Telnet. I prefer to do it with Netcat, but Telnet will also let you connect to a server and type in Japan's directly. It lets you send command lines to a server just without encryption or anything, and that's what you use for HTTP as opposed to HTTPS. All right. And what status code do you get when you load a web page? All right, and 200 is the normal load. Good. All right. Well, let's take a break for 10 minutes. I'll pick up at 10:05. I'll stop this recording. This is chapter 4.